Yeah, any pointers from yesterday's class that you remember, you can share, and then we'll get on to today's topic. So what did we learn yesterday? Anyone who was there yesterday can share what they learned yesterday.
I can try.
Yes.
I can try?
Yes, please.
Yesterday you explained us three important points: thinking, feeling, and what was the third one? Thinking, feeling, and
willing.
So we got to replace it, right? So last night I was feeling low about something. I actually tried, you know, to replace it with a positive point, and it worked up to a certain limit, okay, not much. And then you explained us nothing happens by chance, everything is planned by Lord. And when it comes to your duty, do your duty first, keep your emotions on the side, you can always come back to it later.
Great, thank you for sharing that. Any other points from yesterday's class?
Surabhi and Abhyam can share.
Surabhi, anything from yesterday's class?
We discussed about whether God exists or not, and we also discussed on the fact that whatever the universe is made of, and you know how systematically it is working, so definitely there must be some kind of a power which must be governing it. And we also talked about religions, different kind of religions.
Okay, great. Thank you. That's like a whole summary. Very nice. Any other points, Preeti, Priyanka, Praveen Tiwari as well? And yeah, any other points which you remember from yesterday? Anything which stuck with you, you like, or even Julio, you can share anything from yesterday that you liked or stuck with you, you can share. Nothing? Meghna, Shelza, anyone, any points from yesterday?
We learned how we can control the mind. What are the ways, like the mantra meditation, what you said.
Right.
And I do remember, but I can't speak right now. Let me just think.
It's okay. Yeah, you can think and add some more pointers. Till then, Shelza, if you have any other pointers to add.
Yeah, I can remember. I'm trying to say that we learned that there is God and God does exist. And how do we know that is like how you gave examples, how to explain if someone asks you, have you seen God? Does yes. God exist?
What are the two tricky questions people throw at us?
Is there God? And if there is, then have you seen God?
And the next one?
Can you show me God? Yeah.
And what is the answer to both the questions?
There what? Is God.
No, so have you seen God and can you show me God? What is the answer?
Yes.
So where have you seen God?
No, when we see his creation, we know that like the creation is so beautiful. So we need to know who has created it. It doesn't come just like that, right?
Yeah.
There are a lot of things in this world, even we as an example, as human beings, or all the species, they're all created by God. So if the creator was not there, from where has the creation come?
Right. So we can know that something exists by the symptoms of it. That's one. Second, we are also seeing God right in your DP right now.
That is Radharaman.
Yes. So in one sense, we are looking at Ras Bihari very regularly. So yes, we are seeing God. And can you show me God? What is the answer and how is that possible?
When they say show me God, it's like we have to explain to the person that like we need that kind of devotion and the faith to see God, right? If you do not have the faith, if you do not have the belief, how will you see God?
Okay, what were some of the other arguments we gave for can you show me God?
You need to have a qualification to see the God, certain qualification. And God is not there to take your orders. You know, you can't just tell, you know, come and show and then God will appear. Yeah.
And two more points. What is it? How can you show God to someone? Okay, the negative has been talked about. Okay, you're not qualified. Right, he's not your order carrier. What are the positive? How can you show him actually?
So the example of the painting, so you said yesterday, you know. So who's made that painting? So similarly, I think make
but I, that, I, want you know. To, I want to talk to God face to face. How can you do that? For the sake of everyone else who entered just now, if I want to talk to God face to face, right? Can you show me God? How is that possible? Anyone? Okay, so let me explain how there is a process to see anything, right? We discussed how someone wants to see amoeba, right? He has to first learn what is amoeba, right? Understand, then agree to follow the process, peek into the microscope, go to the lab, peek into the microscope, then he can see the amoeba.
Similarly, and we also said that we are not, you know, our vision is restricted.
Correct.
We cannot see the ultraviolet and the, you know, so correct. How we can say, be assured that our eyes are, you know, will be able to see God.
Yes.
So there was, that was there.
That was another point.
Yes, can I add? I remember now, like, when you say that, what is darkness? It's the absence of light. There is nothing called darkness.
Right.
So similarly, you can tell a person that if there is light, there has to be darkness, right? In the absence of light.
Right.
So, yeah.
Okay. So the simple answer when you say yes, you know, I can show you God, but there's a process to follow, right? It's not that God will, you know, you'll be able to see God instantly just because you want to, right? But you have to actually agree to follow a process. Once you follow the process, you're sure to see God. And you have to follow the process correctly. And the end result for all those who follow the process correctly, right? It's a science. What is science? Science is you have a hypothesis, right? You perform the experiment, basis that hypothesis, and then get the result. So this is actually spiritual science, right? Krishna declares in Bhagavad Gita, Raja Vidya, Raja Guhyam. Right? It's very, very, it's the topmost science and it is very, very secret, but he's declaring it in Bhagavad Gita. It's actually an open secret, right? So he's giving this science in Bhagavad Gita for us to practice. The taste of the pudding is in eating, right? So if there is a gulab jamun, right, kept in front of you, people's mouths are already watering, I can see. Right? There's a gulab jamun kept in front of you. You can, you know, spend years and years doing a PhD on the gulab jamun and still not know what it tastes like. But if you simply pick the gulab jamun, put it in your mouth, right, you immediately know what is a gulab jamun and how it tastes, right? So similarly, this process is actually a science, right? And there are so many people who followed this science, followed this path correctly, and they've got the result. And those are the acharyas whose footsteps we follow. Like there are so many people who claim, oh, who has seen God? Nobody has seen God. You must have heard people saying nobody has seen God, right? So a simple question to such people is, just a simple example. If I have to say there is no gold in China, how much information about China do I need to have to, you know, correctly make this statement? To authoritatively make a statement, there is no gold in China, how much knowledge and information about China I should have?
We need complete knowledge, right?
Exactly, yes. We need to know everything. Every bank locker, every damn thing we need to know about China, the minutest details of all their residents, right? Whether someone is holding some gold or not. That much amount of information one has to know. One has to study every individual in China, right? Every gold mine or every mine, there is no gold. All the land, right? Whatever is inside the land, one has to know to be able to claim that there is no gold in China, right? So if someone is claiming that no one has seen God, have you studied every man on earth to make the statement? Right?
Oh, yeah.
We don't even know 100, 200 people and enough to ask them this question, actually. Forget studying every, like 6, 7, 8 billion people. I don't know how many more are there on the globe, right? So there are people who've, you know, followed this path very, very nicely, followed the process and got the result. Right? So, and immediately one can start having the experience or realization as soon as one begins the process. Not that, yeah, ultimately, of course, you know, the end result is you can actually talk to the Lord face to face. But there is an immediate reciprocation. If I give a gift right now to Praveen, right? Praveen knows I exist, right? Otherwise, gift kaha se hai, right? There won't be a question, does this person really exist who's sending me this gift, right? So there won't be any question or doubt that this person exists. Similarly, if you actually try to connect to God and serve Him, there is an immediate reciprocation from the other end, right? Saamne se bhi signal aa raha hai, which means something is there, right? So one can actually immediately experience as well, right? And as one, you know, connects more and more, the realization grows more and more. Krishna says, "Ye yatha maam prapadyante." As one approaches me, I similarly reciprocate, right? So when we feel the reciprocation of the Lord, when we experience it, there remains no doubt, right? So there is initial faith, Shabda Praman, right? We believe the words of Shastra, right? We perform the experiment, right? We use our Anuman Praman, or, you know, you use our inferences and, you know, try to follow the path correctly. And then finally, there is Pratyaksha Praman, direct experience, right? Okay, so let's start today's session. I'll just quickly share my screen. Yoga for the modern age. I'm actually scared to take this one. There are so many yoga students here. So if I go wrong, please forgive me. Yeah. All right. So again, all that we'll be discussing today is from the teachings of His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada, who's given the topmost yoga, that is Bhakti Yoga, to the world through the medium of Bhagavad Gita and Srimad Bhagavatam and so many other scriptures. All right. So before we dive into what is yoga, let's look at what is not yoga. People are already smiling. So, what is not yoga? Is this yoga? You can unmute and express yourself.
No, this is crazy.
No, this is a stunt. That's it.
Okay, this is not yoga, right? If you Google the word yoga, right? And again, this is, like I said, these are some old slides. And this is again back in 2000, 2001, something. But yeah, even today you will have much more results. So if you Google the word yoga, you have yoga for blood pressure, chair yoga, right? Yoga for kittens. You have, you know, some signal lights going up and down. You have office yoga, right? And you have yoga for pregnancy. You have yoga for weight loss, yoga for back care, yoga secrets for business, desktop yoga, tennis yoga, and the list goes on and on and on, right? Is it, so are these yoga?
No. This is not yoga, but they are using yoga as a, you know, technique here to achieve some goals.
Or as a buzzword. More than technique, also as a buzzword. Yeah.
Yeah. They are just using it as marketing.
But you see, I mean, at least this one, yoga for weight loss, right? It's some very, very famous, right? Yoga for wellness. In that, is that yoga or no?
Like they have picked one of the portion of ancient Ashtang yoga, and even that single portion they have manipulated and modified for marketing, you can say. But yeah, not everyone are like do all sort of yoga, like mental, spiritual or asanas with ease. So they have modified as per the demand. Modern.
Yes, very, very aptly put. Modified as per the demand. Yes. So what is yoga? Yoga actually comes from the root word yuj, right? It's Sanskrit word yuj. Yujate iti yoga, right? The process of linking ourselves with the Supreme is yoga, right? So yujate iti yoga, that which unites is yoga, right? It's from Agni Puran as well. The perfect union of Jivatma with Paramatma is yoga, right? So the question comes, why yoga? Yoga means to connect. Why do we need yoga actually? Now that you know the meaning. Yeah, yes, please go on, Sheldon.
So could it be that, you know, the real purpose of our life or the real purpose as a soul is to, you know, link or meet the higher Supreme. So that's why yoga is required to balance so that we can do that. And yeah, to meet the Supreme or to know, because that's our main goal.
That's very, very intelligent of you to draw that inference so quickly. That's very nice. Yes. So yes, that's true. Any other thoughts on why yoga?
If yoga is not there, how do we connect? Like, my example doesn't make sense, but I'll still try. So, like, just the way a child is connected to the mother through umbilical cord to get new life, so are we connected to God through yoga.
Okay, interesting, yes. Any other thoughts? Why yoga?
I think yoga first helps you connect to your own self, then to connect to God. So you have to connect to your inner self, and the yoga helps you to connect to your inner self, to basically your mind and your soul.
Yes, interesting. Any other thoughts?
For self-realization and to be happy always.
Yes. Short and sweet, yes.
It helps to basically control our mind, body and soul.
Okay, sorry, I lost track of who's talking.
Praveen,
sorry. I was just trying to see who all are talking and I just lost the screen. Okay, yeah.
So I'm saying that it helps us to have a complete control on our mind, body and soul. Then only we can try to achieve something more supreme, like attaching ourselves with God or any other thing. So it's basically a control.
Nice, yes. Anything else?
To increase muscle memory.
To increase your memory?
Muscle memory.
Cell memory.
Muscle.
Muscle memory.
Muscle memory.
Oh, sorry. Muscle memory. Okay. All right. Any other thoughts?
I just want to add to Mr. Praveen what he said. I think controlling as well as balancing, there has to be a balance. And when there is a balance, then only you'll be able to connect to oneself and then able to connect to support.
Very right. Yes. Any other thoughts? Any last words? Why yoga?
Hey Krishna Prabhuji.
Yes, Prabhu.
I think it's for making the body fit for getting the higher knowledge and going on the path of self-realization.
Okay. Right. Anyone who's not spoken? Anyone left out? Wants to add?
Good evening, sir. Good evening, everybody. Apologies for joining in late. Kasturi here.
Yes,
sir. I think yoga connects your mind, body, and soul, and helps in the proper synchronized activity of all three.
So when we hear the definition, I guess if you've just joined, you might have missed the definition of yoga. So I'll just go a slide back for your sake, right? Sorry. So yoga literally means to connect or to unite, right? That which unites is yoga. And it's the perfect union of Jivatma with Paramatma is called yoga, right? So yoga literally means to connect to God. So the question is, why yoga? And you're saying because it connects the body, the soul, and the mind, right? Which is also correct, absolutely right. But at the end of the day, we are also trying to connect to God because that's the real meaning of yoga. So my question is, why do we need to connect? Why yoga?
Because, can I try? Yes. Because I feel that we originally do not belong here. We belong somewhere else and we have to go back there. And in that, for that process, we need to connect.
You saw my slide. I'm saying you saw my next slide, is it?
No, I didn't.
Okay.
I think since we are part of the Paramatma, so it is important that we understand, realize that, and we see that connection.
Okay.
It's basically, I think, required for us to go back home.
Okay. Okay.
To be at peace, maybe.
Be at peace. Okay. Yes. So all your answers are absolutely correct, and a simple and short answer of why yoga. Why do we really need to connect? Right? Because right now we're disconnected. Right? Or at least not completely connected. Right, therefore yoga. So let's see what our real situation is, right? So like I think Meghna Mataji was mentioning that we have to go back home, back to God. So what is that back home, back to God, right? So let's understand this. Why did creation happen, right? That's like one of the questions even I thought as a small child, that what is really purpose of my life? Why am I here? Everyone is just, doing their work in the day, right? Eating food, sleeping at night, doing the same thing all over again the next day, and the same thing all over again the third day, the fourth day, the fifth day, and it goes on and on and on and on, right? What is the meaning of all this? Like, I'm sure a lot of you all must have, thought similarly, or maybe I am just the odd man out, but I'm sure there are many people who go through such thought process, and early on in childhood as well, right? So what is the meaning of this entire creation? Why was this world created? So we'll quickly understand that a little bit, right? So the soul, we understood that we are not this body, we are the soul. Everyone is clear with that, I hope, right? So the soul belongs to the spiritual world. There's a spiritual world, right? Krishna describes in Bhagavad Gita, natat bhasite suryo na shashanko na bhavaka yad gatva na nivartante tad dhama paramam mama. So he's saying that there is a spiritual kingdom which is beyond this material creation, wherein there is no need of sunlight or electricity or moonlight. It's self-illuminated, right? Like I said, Jesus Christ also said about the kingdom of God, like, come to the kingdom of God. So, and in all, bona fide religions, there is a description somewhere or the other, or the mention of the kingdom of God, right? So what is this kingdom of God, right? So it's actually called as the spiritual world, right? And we can get into the details of, you know, the concept of heaven, hell, and so many other things, and people, how they confuse heaven with the spiritual world altogether. So this entire material creation in Bhagavad Gita 15th chapter is described as a Urdhva Moola Dashaka. It's described as a banyan tree which is upside down. Can you see this picture where Lord Brahma is sitting on the roots of a banyan tree which is like spread everywhere? Right? You're able to see? So this material creation is compared to a upside down banyan tree. Right now, why an upside down banyan tree? So if any one of you have been near, you know, a lake, so and a tree which is nearby, it's reflected in the water, right? And how is it reflected in the water? It's upside down, right? The tree will, the roots will be down and the, you know, bushes will be up, but in the water the roots will be up and the bushes will be down, or, you know, further away like that. So this describes, and using that analogy, Krishna is describing in the 15th chapter that how this material creation is actually a perverted reflection of the spiritual world, right? Which means that the amount of variety that you see in the material creation, there is all of that and even much more in the spiritual world, but in its original form, it's not perverted. Now, when we say perverted, what it means that if in the spiritual world there is love, it gets, you know, completely opposite on the other side, ultra reflection, and, you know, appears as lust in the material world. Everyone here, they want to, you know, be on the top, right? Everyone wants to become number one, isn't it? Right? It's completely the reverse in the spiritual world. Everyone wants to serve the other person, right? Krishna himself, right, who's, you know, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, there's a transcendental competition between the Lord and his devotees to who will serve the other person like that. It's a very, very, and there are so many pastimes like that, which are so beautiful and pleasing, right, when you hear them. So there's a transcendental competition, literally, and Krishna wants to serve his devotees. And how do we see that? As, and very clearly we can see in, on the cover of Bhagavad Gita itself, that how, you know, Krishna is taking such a humble position of a driver, right, for his devotee. Krishna is actually becoming a chariot driver for Arjuna, isn't it? And Sarathi, right? It's called Sarathi. So Sarathi, the position is not very, very high, elevated, right? So how, you know, in the battlefield, people would, you know, treat, use the Sarathi to move around, because on the battlefield, there is a lot of noise, right? There are so many big, big weapons being used. There are, you know, nuclear weapons being used also in the form of Brahmastras, etc. So there is a lot of noise, right? People fighting with swords, etc. So to indicate the Rathi or Maharathi, which means the person who is on the Ratha, to indicate to the driver whether you have to go left or right, instead of saying, because he cannot speak loud enough for the driver to hear, he would actually put his feet on the shoulders of the Sarathi. And if he has to, you know, turn left, he would press the right foot, the right shoulder would be bent. So the driver will turn left. And if you have to turn right, the other foot and the Sarathi will take right. So that is the kind of position Krishna assumed for his devotee Arjuna. Imagine, right? So that's the, you know, relationships and loving exchanges in the spiritual world. That it's a competition of who will serve, you know, the other person more. Like that. But here our competition is how I will become the boss of the other. Right? How will I lord it over and, you know, show my position and power? Right? So it's completely opposite. And spirit, the soul, belongs to the spiritual world, right? Matter belongs to the material world. So this body made of earth, water, fire, air, ether, it belongs to the material world. Whereas the spirit soul, we ourselves, we belong to the spiritual world. Now, because we are here, we are in an incompatible situation, right? Like I said yesterday, you know, we are eternal. The body has to die. We are full of knowledge, but we have to study ABC. We are we are supposed to be full of happiness, but we are struggling for a little happiness here and there, right? So that's our situation. And why this whole material world was created, I'll come to that in a bit. I'll just give you an example of our situation so that we understand the gravity of our situation here. So a quick story. So there was this there was a king by the name Madhubindu, right? And one day what he did was he took a lot of intoxication, a lot of liquor he drank, and he fed liquor to his elephant also. And then he got on top of that same elephant and went in the jungle. Now, because of all that intoxication, the elephant went mad. He took him from behind and threw him, right? And as soon as, he fell on the ground, he came to his senses like, oh God, my life is in danger right now. And he started running. And this elephant started chasing him like mad, right? And running at a point, he came, at a point where there is a cliff. And he jumped. And there was a tree at the edge of the cliff, which was just, leaning out in the valley. And he caught hold of one of the branches. Now, he's hanging there, and the elephant from behind comes. The elephant, he cannot reach. It's too far, right? The guy is too far. So what it does, it starts pushing the tree. It starts shaking the tree. And this fellow, he's holding on tight to the branch. He's like really scared now. Like this elephant, if he catches me, I'll be gone, right? So now the elephant is shaking the tree. So he's scared. And he looks down. Like, niche to dekh lo kya hai. Right. So when he looks down, he finds a dry well and a big black cobra waiting for him. So he thought, ki, are, niche gira to gaya. the cobra will in no time will, crush me. So he's like imminent death, niche baitha hai, right? And then he thought, this branch is only support I have. Till the time this branch is there, I'm alive. So he thought, let me look at how strong the branch is. So he looked at the end of the branch, and there were two rats, one black, one white, chewing on the branch. And like, arey bapre, in a matter of time, the branch will break and I'll fall down. And what was happening was, because the elephant was constantly pushing the tree, there was a beehive right on the upper branch, and the bees were getting disturbed. And they started coming out and started stinging this fellow. And now he's crying out in pain. Oh, right. He's crying out in pain. And he starts calling out, help, 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 please save me. Right. He's calling out for help. He's crying. It's a very, very terrible condition, right? And suddenly in all of this, right, when all of this is going on, something happens. And this guy starts enjoying. Uh-huh. Some few drops of honey from the beehive on top falls on his tongue, right? And this guy starts enjoying, wow, so sweet, so nice, right? Starts enjoying. And two drops of honey fall every 2 hours, right? Two drops of honey every 2 hours. And this guy is like enjoying the honey, right? Some people nearby, they were passing by, they see this man's condition and they come to the spot and like, hey, come jump this side, right? They make some arrangement, right? Hey, come jump this side, jump this side. So we'll save you, come. Like, save? What save? I'm enjoying here. This is so sweet honey. I'm enjoying. Right? He forgets, the elephant, the cobra waiting down, the bee stinging, right? The rats chewing the branch. He forgets everything. And he's enjoying the honey. Two drops every 2 hours. Right? So this Madhubindu is no one but us, right? It's our situation actually, So what is the elephant? The elephant is our mind, which is so huge like an elephant because it's filled with hundreds of desires which keep pushing us, right? Like it's pushing the tree. It keeps pushing us, right? To do this, to do that, to get involved in 100 things, right? And as a result, you know, there are bees which are getting disturbed and they're stinging us. These are our daily problems, right? Which sting us like the bee sting, right? The black cobra waiting down is death. The branch is our lifespan. And the two rats, black and white, chewing on the branch, right, is day and night, which is taking away our lifespan slowly and steadily, right? And the people who are there to save us, right, they're calling out, "Ki, come jump this side," are the sadhus or the sages who are trying to guide us, "Come this side, you'll be saved," right? But we are very happy. No, I'm enjoying, right? 2 drops of honey every 2 hours, right? That is the amount of happiness we get in this material world, right? It's like having 20 inches of bread, right, on 2 sides and 1 thin layer of butter in the middle, right? Nobody would like to have such a sandwich, isn't it? But we are so foolish that we fall for it, right? We are still holding on, saying that, "Oh, I'm enjoying. I don't want to be saved," right? The 2 drops, 2 hours is too good, like that. So that's our situation, and the nature of material happiness is such, right? The thing which is giving you happiness right now, in a matter of time, the same thing becomes cause of distress. Right? Let's take a quick example. So, Praveen, right? Are you sitting in a comfortable position? Sorry.
No, not very much.
Okay, please sit in a comfortable position immediately, please. You're in a comfortable position now?
Yes.
Okay. So if I ask you, Praveen, to sit in the same position for next 4 hours.
Yeah.
Right? The same position, which is giving you comfort at this point, will become cause of trouble later. You'll have to shift, you'll have to stand, you'll have to sleep, something, right?
Right.
So that is the nature of material happiness. The thing which is giving me happiness or comfort right now at this point, in a matter of time, will become the cause of discomfort or distress later, right? That is a dual nature of material happiness. It's like two sides of the same coin, right? It comes in a package, right? So be it any object, right? People love their iPhones, right? Oh, it's the source of my happiness. But yeah, when the iPhone is lost or it breaks, the one crack in the glass is the crack in the heart, right? So the same object becomes cause of distress and pain, right? Similarly, any person, any relationship, right? So whatever in the material world we experience in terms of people, objects, relationship, if they're giving us happiness and pleasure right now, in a matter of time, the same people or objects will be the cause of distress and pain. Right? That's the dual nature of the material happiness, right? But we are spiritual beings. We learn that we are Sat, Chit, and Anand, right? We are eternal, full of knowledge and happiness, right? So we are looking for permanent happiness, isn't it? Right? So how do we get that? How do we get that? This is not something worth finding out, right? How do we get that?
Yeah, we are truly happy when we are devoted to God and connected with God. Yes.
So when we connect to the source, right? So just like we are Sat Chit Anand, right? We are part and parcel of God. So God is the original source. He is also Satchit Anand. We are same in similar in quality, right? But different in quantity, right? We are Anu. We are the minute particle, whereas he is the Vibhu. He is the supreme, right? So just like when you have a big fire, and one particle, one small spark or flame separates from the fire, it loses its quality slowly, right? And you'll find that red particle, a grass particle or something from the fire, you know, coming out, and then it loses the quality of fire. It becomes just some ash after some time, right? But when the same particle put back in the fire, a connected back will again burn, just like the fire. So similarly, we being part and parcel of God, we are also Satchit Anand. Krishna is also Satchit Anand. He's the source, right? When we connect back to him, right, it's just like putting a metal inside the furnace, the metal also becomes fire. So when we can come in contact with the source of all happiness, naturally we cannot remain sad, right? We cannot remain sad. So when we connect to God, we are naturally internally very, very happy. And that's where we belong actually in the spiritual world. But right now we are in an incompatible situation. So why did we come here really, right? Why God sent us here? Is that a question which you think I should answer?
Because we wanted to enjoy on our own.
So there's a small girl, and in fact, this happened. So me and my mentor, we had gone to one life member's house, and he was talking to the life member, and I was just sitting around. And there's a small girl, the person's daughter, she came, and she said, Papa, you know, I've cooked dal. You eat dal. And she, to us also, please, you know, uncle, please take dal, right? And then we said, oh, where is roti? Kahan se dal khayenge? Roti chahiye. So she got another small thing, like roti lo, right? So, and she was so serious. She was damn serious. And if we did not take now, she was like, so she was very, very serious. Please take roti and dal, right? With her toy kitchen items, right? She made dal and roti and gave it to us. So we are all happily, you know, enacted, yes, very nice, very tasty, you made very nice, right? And then she went off to play, and, you know, my mentor, he continued talking to this life member. And after half an hour or so, right, this girl started, you know, calling to the mother, Mummy, bhook lagi hai. And I start thinking, what happened to that dal and roti which she made, right? What happened to that? So there was no real dal. She was just enacting, of course, right? So the mother basically had got her a toy kitchen because she wanted to cook herself, right? The daughter wanted to cook, but obviously she cannot cook in the kitchen for the husband, right? So the mother got her a toy kitchen to play. But when the girl was really hungry, right, she knew you have to go to the mother and get the food, the real food. Similarly, we also wanted to play God, right? Just like this girl wanted to play ghar or kitchen, whatever you call it, right? We also wanted to play God. We were all there in the spiritual world. Like I said, we belong to the spiritual world, right? We were all there in the spiritual world with God, with Krishna, right? And but we wanted to play God. We thought, why God is God, why I am not God? Right? Because Krishna is a supreme enjoyer, right? The Purusha means enjoyer, right? And the Purusha and Prakriti is the enjoyed, right? So Krishna is the only enjoyer. There cannot be any other enjoyer, right? So, but we wanted to play God, right? So God said, fine, okay, you want to play God? Okay, he created the material world where actually nothing belongs to us. But we can still say, oh, this is my house, this is my car, right? My wife, my children, right? My country, right? Nothing. The body also doesn't belong to you. It's a temporary, rent pe liya hua hai. The body also doesn't belong to you. It's there for only a temporary time period. But we can say these things. Yeah, this is mine, that is mine. And we are all trying to lord it over. We are all trying to be the boss. We are all trying to be God, right? I want to be, you know, the number one. I want to be the boss of 10,000 people in the company, etc., etc., right? We all want to have such positions. We all want to, you know, be on the top, right? Why? Because of this nature or the original sin that we committed, that, oh, I want to be God. I want to be the enjoyer, right? So, like I explained the other day, this finger cannot enjoy separately, right? And it can only enjoy when it serves the whole body by putting the food in the mouth. Similarly, we can only enjoy and we can actually derive the great satisfaction and enjoyment when we serve God, right? When we connect to God through service. So that's the only way that we can actually relish or enjoy some happiness. Look at this guy, right? He's trying all possible things, right? There is a, you know, nice burger in the oven, right? There's a car waiting outside. He's trying to watch, you know, different radio behind, television behind. He's in the tub, right? He's tried cigarette, beer, right? Everything he's trying, right? Look at his face. How miserable, right? So, no amount of sense pleasure can actually satisfy us. Scriptures describe how it's actually pouring. If you try to satisfy your senses, it's like a hungry fire. If you pour ghee, it'll just, you know, grow bigger and bigger. So, no amount of sense gratification can actually satisfy you. The more you try to gratify your senses, the more the fire will become bigger and bigger and bigger, right? You will want more and more and more, right? You must have, you know, I don't know how many people have done this, but, you know, when in school we used to go to temple, right? Sometimes, you know, Hanuman Mandir mil gaya, koi aur temple mil gaya, oh God, please pass kara dena, bas yehi chahiye aur kuch nahi maang raha, right? Just this one wish, right? We'll offer you 4 nariyal, 5 nariyal, whatever, right? Just this one wish, right? And when the guy, he gets good marks, he passes, then the next year, oh, please, wapas pass kara do, please, right? And then when that happens, only, oh, please, one job, you know, just get me a good job. I will ask for nothing else. When you get that, oh, you know, just get me a good wife or a good husband and, you know, I'm done. I'm settled, right? And then it goes on and on and on and on and on. Oh, this promotion, that thing. So no matter how much you satisfy your senses, it's never going to be sufficient. It's just going to grow. The fire will go bigger, bigger and bigger, right? And the emptiness of heart will become more and more and more and more. Right? There's a vacuum in the heart, right? There's a vacuum in the heart and that can be only filled by Krishna, right? That vacuum can only be filled by Krishna, no matter what you get. Right, no matter what material opulence you accumulate, the biggest bungalow, you know, the best of the cars, you know, the most obedience of the wise, or you know, the best of the husbands, that gap in the heart won't be filled. That place belongs to the Lord. Who can, you know, fill up the space which is for the Lord? Right? Who can match Him? Right? That space in the heart can only be filled by Krishna. And George Harrison very beautifully writes in the preface for Krishna book. There's a book called Krishna book. So George Harrison, who's one of the famous Beatles, he's written the preface where he says, everyone is looking for Krishna, bracket love, right? Some people know it, some people don't know it, right? So it's better to know that we are actually looking for Krishna, and that gap can only be filled by Krishna, nothing else. Once you understand that, you'll stop running after things, right? And when you actually work towards getting Krishna in your heart, that gap will be filled. So our situation is just like fish out of water, right? Like I said, we are spirit. We belong to the spiritual world. Now in the material world, we are out of water. No matter what you give the best of the burgers and pizzas to a fish out of water, or the, you know, Rolls Royce car standing next door. the fish won't be satisfied. Just put it back in the water and you'll be happy, right? So this is our situation when we are not connected, right? So what happens? What is the result if I connect to God? What will happen, right? So this brings us to a quick story. So there was this boy who actually wanted to learn karate, okay? And this person, basically, he never had his left arm, right? So wherever, whichever school he went to, he was rejected. You know, people laughed at him. You don't have one arm. You know, go get some job for a good living. Why would you want to learn karate? Are you crazy? Like that, right? So he was rejected practically from all the places. Right? Finally, he went to, you know, the best school for karate in the entire China region. He went there. And, you know, one of the very well-known, most famous master he went to. And he literally begged him, please, you know, let me enter your school. I've been rejected from all places, right? So the master tested him a little bit. No. Just to see how serious this boy is, right? But he's like, no, I won't go, right? I will just stay here outside only. Please, you need to teach me. So the master said, yes, fine, you're welcome. So he allowed him to join. But he said, one condition, whatever I say, you need to follow. If you, you know, show any doubts in me, then you can go your way. So he said, okay, I won't doubt you. Teach. So this master started training the boy, right? So he taught him for first 1 month, 2 months, he taught him defense, basics, defense, how to defend himself. If some opponent is attacking, how to defend himself, and different techniques, he taught him how to defend himself. Then after those 2 months, he taught him one punch, right? So he said, this is, you know, one good punch. You practice this for 2 months. So 2 months straight, you know, this boy was just practicing this one punch, right? And then after 2 months, he was quite good with this punch. And he again went to the master. He said, okay, tell me what next. He said, practice the same punch for next 4 months. And, you know, he looked a little doubtful. He saw other kids are learning different things to kick and to, you know, do so many different things. But you know, he's just saying 4 months, one punch, right? So he said, but I should not doubt my master. He already, you know, warned me. So he obeyed. Like, okay, fine, I'll go. And day and night, he was practicing this one single punch for 4 months straight. And then when he came back again to the master said, go back again, practice the same punch for 6 months. He was already an expert in the punch. And now he had serious doubts. And the master, he noticed, like, do you want to learn or you want to be out? So the boy said, okay, fine. He was in pressure, like, okay, fine. I will learn. And he followed. Although he was not knowing, but he went on and on and on, you know, practicing this punch. Now he was such a master in this one punch. So at the end of the year, there was a tournament held where all the different schools, they came together to have this competition. And, you know, there were students of different schools. And this master also was choosing students for the tournament. So he had picked up a lot of, you know, some very, very good students. And somehow, to everyone's surprise, he picked up this boy as well. Everyone was wondering, ye ek haath ke saath ek punch aata hai, right? Aur kuch nahi aata hai. How will he, you know, even be in the ring for a few seconds, right? So, you know, they went for the tournament. Now, one by one, what happened was all the other students of this master, they started losing, right? After different matches, a lot of these boys, they were losing. Somehow this boy was winning, right? And what was he doing? He knew defense, right? So whenever the opponent would attack, he would, you know, try to defend himself somehow or the other. And then he would see that gap and give this one punch. And this punch was so powerful, and he was an expert, that the person would be knocked out in one punch. So like that, he went on and on and on, right? And he reached the quarterfinals. It was very, very difficult. You know, the opponent was really heavy. It was like, you know, not giving him any scope. He was just, you know, punching him, kicking him here and there. And this boy was like, you know, almost falling down. But somewhere then the other opponent got tired, and he saw that gap and he gave that punch, knockout, right? Semi-finals again was super, super difficult, right? And he almost lost, right? And the master like, come on, get up. He was almost knocked out. Somehow he gathered strength, again got up. And again, the other person did not allow him to breathe. He was constantly, you know, left, right, center, hitting him. And, you know, he was somehow managing to stay on his feet, right? All punches, kicks were coming on left, right, and center. And he saw that gap, gave that one punch, knockout. Now he's in the finals, right? Everybody's scratching his head. How this boy has come to the finals, right? Unimaginable, right? And the final, as the bell rang, right, the other person, he started beating him black and blue, right? This boy was beaten black and blue. He fell to the ground hundreds of times and almost, you know, lost consciousness, right? But the master said, please give him a chance, please give him a chance, right? And somehow the other, you know, the boy was, he got up. And again, the person was beating him left, right, and center. He finally saw one gap, gave that punch, and the opponent was knocked out. So he won the trophy. Everyone was surprised, right? And now they're walking back, right, after the tournament with the trophy in his hand. The boy, the master, all the students, they're walking, right? And the boy had tears in his eyes. Even the master had tears in his eyes, right? So the boy said, master, how did I win? Right? How did I win? The master said, there are two reasons for you to win. One is the punch, you know, is the most strategic and powerful punch in entire teachings of karate. And you are a master of that punch. Nobody can beat you on that, right? And the second reason for you to win is that the only defense to that punch is that the opponent has to hold your left hand, which you do not have. So the greatest weakness was turned into the greatest strength. This is what connecting to God can do to us. Krishna can turn our greatest weaknesses into our greatest strengths. So,
very nice.
Sorry?
That was incredible.
Yeah. So when you connect to God, right, he can actually, or, you know, a bona fide spiritual master, he can actually turn our greatest weaknesses, take that, you know, mixture of, jaisa bhi hai, kaisa bhi hai, teda hai, par mera hai. Krishna says, right, whatever he is mine, right? When he says that, you can actually turn your greatest weaknesses into greatest strengths. So I was a person who was very, very shy. You know, I was afraid to even talk on phone with someone. And here I am talking to you guys. Sorry. Okay, so before we move on to the next section, I think it's already 5:15. We'll take a quick break. If there is any question, let's address that. And then we'll go on a quick break for 2 to 5 minutes, and then we'll continue. I'm aiming to finish today on time. So let's see. Any questions?
If you could touch upon that point, why this world was created. So
forgot that. Thank you so much for reminding. I almost lost the point there. Thank you so much. So this world was created just like we explained the example of the toy kitchen, right? So we committed two original sins, like why God is God, why I'm not God. And in the spiritual world, it is such a place. It's described as Chintamani Prakara Satmasu Kalpa Viksha Laksha Viteshu Surabhir Vipalayantam Lakshmi Sahasra Shastra Sambrahma Sevyamanam Govinda Madhi Purusham Tamaham Bhajami. So it's described as Chintamani Dham, which means that the entire spiritual world is made of touchstone, right? Not a touchstone which just gives you gold, but a touchstone which fulfills all your desires. There are desire trees, right? So spiritual world is such a place that anything you desire immediately gets fulfilled, right? And 75% of the entire population in the entire existence, right, I should say, is there in the spiritual world, actually, right? In the material world, and when I say material world, it's not just one earth, it's actually not just one solar system or a galaxy or a universe, it's millions and trillions of universes, actually. So the entire material creation is just 25% of the population. 75% is with Krishna, right? Or with the Lord. So why was this created again? Just because we desire to enjoy separately. It's also, you can compare it with, say, for example, a school or maybe a jail, right? Why does government create jail?
To put them in a different world.
Not to put them in a different world, but for reformation, right?
Yeah.
So that the person is reformed. If someone is creating havoc somewhere on the street, yeah, they'll catch him, put him in the jail so that he comes to his senses, and after a few days he's left, right? It depends on the gravity of the kind of crime committed. He's given that kind of punishment. And no state wants to create jail, right? But they are forced to create jail because there are people who break the law, correct? Similarly, we wanted to enjoy separately, and that's not possible, actually, right? Therefore, the Lord had to create this world. And now that we are in the jail, right, our main business should be to, how do I get out? By get out, I don't mean die, because even if you die, you still remain in the same cycle of, 84 lakh species, birth, death, old age, and disease. These four things will still continue, right? When I mean get out, I mean get out of the cycle of birth and death and go back home, back to God, back to the spiritual world, and not remain in the material world. Even the heavens, right, what we call Swargaloka, right, Brahma Loka, all these are actually part of the material creation. You saw Brahma on top of the banyan tree, the upside down banyan tree. So even the heavens, the hells, everything is part of the material creation, whereas the spiritual world is completely separate. Right, and actually that forms the entire existence, and the material creation is just like a cloud floating in the spiritual sky. It's described in the scriptures how it's comparing the material world just like a cloud floating in the spiritual sky, and in our terms it's just like a small jail in the state. Right, the state is really huge, but the jail is small, right? And it's meant for people who are disobedient and not following the law, and it's meant for reformation, right? So our main business here is to understand that we do not belong here, right? Our main business is to get out. And living in the jail, right? If someone is telling you, this is the way to get out, right? Come here, I have a small tunnel, we can move out, right? And you say, no, what get out? There are so many stones to break. Jail mein hota na, kaise log patthar todte hain, right? So we are concerned, Ari, how many stones are there? Who will break, right? I have to break so many stones. How can I, get out of the jail? We are so foolish, right? We are busy breaking the stones. And someone comes along to show us a path out of the jail. We are saying, no, I don't have time. I have to break so many stones, right? That's our situation. So why? Yes, living in the jail, you will have to break the stones, right? To exist there, but at the same time you need to work on how to get out of the jail. In fact, there's a quick concept I'll probably try and touch upon, and maybe we can take it towards the end if we have time. But there's a concept of free will and destiny, right? So destiny is a set of circumstances I'm put into whereas free will is my choice in those circumstances, how do I choose to react, right? So it's not that everything is predestined, or it's not that everything is in my hands only, right? So there is destiny and there is free will, both, right? And depending on our choices, we create our future destiny. So if you're choosing, you know, to maintain your body, yes, we have to maintain our bodies. We have to, you know, earn a living. But at the end of the day, we also need to work towards getting out of the jail, right? I hope that answers your question.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, great. All right. Should we take a... what was I asking before this? Okay, okay. So let's take a quick break, unless anyone has any other questions or comments.
I had a question.
Yes.
Actually. So right now you said that the material world is 25% and 75% is with the Lord. Hmm. So, and then... And this 25% also has the other multiverses, if you want to call it that way. Like, yes. Not just one universe, but yes. Multiple universes.
Yes.
So do you still, do you think that, I mean, there must be other beings there as well as they are in this universe?
Of course.
So yes. Is it so that the entire 25%, like it's the same thing for all the 25% people here? Like not just human beings, any other kind of creatures also?
Yes.
So the entire 25% of the people are in reformation center kind of a thing.
Correct.
If that's right.
That includes all the species, not just human beings.
I just wanted to clarify that. Thank you.
Yes. That's correct. Good question. Okay. So let's take a quick break. Today we want to finish early. So let's take a 2 minutes break and come back. Okay. All right. Thank you.